One of the most important developments in astronomy has been the unbelievably successful launch, deployment, and commencement of the science mission of the James Webb Space Telescope. It could be said that the telescope is off and running, making multiple observations per day, working through its catalog of time booked on the telescope by science teams around the world. And while the telescope is primarily designed to probe the earliest stages of the universe and look at the most distant objects we've ever seen, it also offers much promise in the search for extraterrestrial life. The first development here highlights the possibility for exoplanet research in that JWST has already directly imaged an exoplanet. Taking direct images of exoplanets has been difficult and has only been accomplished in a handful of cases before. The reason is that most exoplanets are discovered through indirect means, either through the planet transiting its star and blocking out light, or through gravitational wobbling induced on the parent star. Actually, imaging an exoplanet is much more difficult for a variety of reasons, ranging from being too close to their star to resolve, to being too dim or otherwise difficult to see. Taking direct images of exoplanets has been difficult and has only been accomplished in a handful of cases before. The reason is that most exoplanets are discovered through indirect means, either through the planet transiting its star and blocking out light, or through the gravitational wobbling induced on the parent star. Actually, imaging an exoplanet is much more difficult for a variety of reasons, ranging from being too close to their star to resolve, to being too dim or otherwise difficult to see. But in the case of giant planets, it can be more easily done. In this case, it's an exoplanet known as HIP-65426b, and is about 12 times more massive than Jupiter. It's also a remarkably young planet, only having formed a few tens of millions of years ago from our perspective. It was a known exoplanet since its discovery in 2017, and orbits very distantly from its parent star, making it an ideal candidate for direct imaging, while blocking out the light from the star with a mask. While this is a gas giant and not a rocky planet, and not a candidate for a biosphere, it shows well the astonishing capabilities of JWST. But with biospheres, just how will the telescope search for them, and what might it find? The answer lies in just how light behaves when it passes through a planet's atmosphere. The telescope will use the transit method for this. So when an exoplanet passes in front of its parent star from our perspective, it not only will block light, its atmosphere will also change the characteristics of the star's light and reveal information about the planet's atmospheric composition. It's useful here to think about Earth and what observers elsewhere in the galaxy might see when they point their telescopes here. If they were observing from billions of light years away, which is a thought experiment as it's highly unlikely anyone at that distance could resolve Earth, but if they could, they wouldn't see a biosphere. Early on in the history of life on this planet, our biosphere was made up of the very simplest microbial life. As a result, any biosignature Earth was giving off during the early days is not likely to have been visible at a great distance. This means that worlds with very faint, very primitive biosignatures are unlikely to be spotted. But then came the great oxygenation event of about 2.4 billion years ago. This was the advent of photosynthesis, and Earth's atmospheric makeup being increasingly oxygenated. This Webb can see. Oxygen is highly reactive. You can see this with rusting iron and how fast it can happen. This makes it very useful for complex biology, though simple biology often finds it poisonous. But the reactivity of oxygen yields a strong biosignature. Since it likes to react, any free oxygen must be constantly replenished in an exoplanet's atmosphere, or have nothing to react with. As a result, if you see high oxygen levels on a rocky exoplanet, there has to be a source, and the source for it here on Earth is photosynthesizing life. If JWST detects this across its decades-long run, we will have our first candidates for biosignatures. And just maybe, we may know that at least plant life, whether algae or otherwise, is common or rare in the universe. In short, we may be able to say that we're not alone in the universe as far as life goes. But the rest may be left to the imagination, such as carnivorous alien death plants that prevent further evolution by eating anything that gets to that level. But there may be more. There is also a peculiar feature in the infrared spectrum that Earth exhibits. It's called the vegetative red edge, where Earth's plants become highly reflective in infrared light. Due to their cell structure, they become almost mirror-like, and it's conceivable that JWST might detect this. In this case, we could infer the presence of chlorophyll directly, and then hypothesized that we're seeing analogs of perhaps complex planets. But this all works within the framework of a rocky planet like Earth. We know what Earth life does, but we don't know what alien life is like, so it's possible that biosignatures might be picked up by JWST that we're unfamiliar with, and we haven't even thought of yet. But there's one area of great interest that presents a wild card, super-Earths. With previous instruments, super-Earths were discovered ranging from twice the mass of Earth to 10 times the mass of Earth, but short of ice giant-sized planets like Uranus or Neptune, super-Earths have turned out to be very common, so much so that it's now seen as a little weird that our solar system doesn't have one, though there have been suggestions that the hypothesized planet 9 that may lurk in the outer solar system may be a super-Earth ejected from the inner solar system early in our system's history. It's been an open question just how big a super-Earth can be and support life without being too big. The first concern, obviously, is that it has to be placed in the right area of its star system within the habitable zone. But the bigger the mass, the more atmosphere it can hold onto, so this means thick atmospheres for larger super-Earths, which is probably a showstopper for life as we know it at some point. Another question is the presence of a magnetic field, which is a complete unknown how common or rare those are in exoplanets. All we can really say here is that Earth has one, but Venus and Mars, not so much. It's also possible that super-Earths have very strong and robust magnetic fields, or it's some mixed bag where some do, some do not. Ultimately, the best guess here is that only the smallest super-Earths, not much bigger than twice the mass of Earth, could conceivably host life. This would eliminate most super-Earths, but super-Earths again are very common, so there still is the possibility for habitable super-Earths. And there are always Earth analogs of a similar size to Earth, which we know represent a very good class of planet for the possibility of life. Smaller worlds, however, start to run into the problems of our own planets. Mars was once habitable and certainly had liquid water for a long period, but lost it simply due to not being big enough to hold on to a thick, Earth-like atmosphere. And there's another aspect that's recently come up that may alter the equation as to whether a planet can harbor life. It's actually impacts, such as Earth's late heavy bombardment. Recent work from NASA's Grail spacecraft has shown that the moon actually has a really porous surface, extending down at least 4 kilometers, that's on the order of 12% empty space, and below that, 4%. That's extremely porous and quite surprising for the moon. Models have shown that this is due to impacts, and is applicable to Earth, Mars, and the moon. Sustained impacts can apparently have long-reaching effects on the overall porosity of planets. This means that Earth's crust, as it originally was early in its history, was shattered, cracked, and pulverized very widely. This may have an effect on life, providing cracks and voids for water and allowing for microbial life to reproduce and spread, shielded to some degree from the massive impacts that were going on during the late heavy bombardment. This might explain why life on Earth arose during that period, when it seems like the environment should have been too harsh while under bombardment, and may also provide a medium of water and volcanic glasses for RNA to arise, as recent work has shown how that happens in such an environment. It may well be that life on Earth began underground. And this is applicable to exoplanets because those conditions may be critical for abiogenesis, and exoplanets that did not see as heavy of a bombardment may not have had the porosity needed for life to easily get going. But that brings us to another interesting aspect of JWST's mission, its ability to search for water. The search for exoplanets with water has been progressing. Recently, an exoplanet known as Ross 508b was discovered orbiting just within the habitable zone of its red dwarf parent star. At just 37 light years away, this super-Earth is really close, making it an excellent target for study and answering at least some of the questions of just how life-friendly red dwarf star systems are. While not a candidate for JWST due to the method of how it was discovered, this discovery shows that our understanding of exoplanets and our ability to characterize them is increasing. But there also has been a second recent discovery, and this one JWST can investigate further. This exoplanet is known as TOI-1452b, and is located in a binary star system made up of 2 red dwarfs. Discovered by the TESS satellite, this exoplanet is about 100 light years away. Importantly, this exoplanet transits in front of one of the red dwarfs, opening the way for JWST to characterize its atmosphere. and it's actually turning out to be eerily Earth-like. This exoplanet has a diameter of 1.67 times that of Earth, but significantly more massive, so is a super-Earth that orbits its host red dwarf every 11 days. But there's something strange. Scientists working with the Canada-France-Hawaii telescope were able to determine the planet's bulk density. The results were that something between 22 and 30% of the planet's mass seems to be water. Given its position within the habitable zone, this is likely to be liquid, making this a potential oceanic planet with a temperate climate. This is by far the best candidate yet for an oceanic world, and a prime candidate for JWST to search its atmosphere for biosignatures. Indeed, if it were to come back that this planet has oxygen, then it would become a serious question as to whether we're looking at an algae planet. But there are also pitfalls with observing exoplanets with JWST. A method of confusing JWST's exoplanet observations has recently been raised. The uncertainty comes in with the possibility that any strange results JWST might come up with raises the possibility that the observation might be incorrect due to the presence of two exoplanets in the same frame. With two different planets, confusing the spectrograph, it may yield confounding results in some observations. As a result, this may make observations more difficult than what was envisioned. But there may be ways around this kind of contamination, such as using multiple telescopes to check results, or making observations over time to compare and determine if there was contamination, and other methods. So it's not a showstopper per se, but rather something that will have to be taken into account when interpreting exoplanet atmosphere data from JWST, and confirming observations may become key. In the end, however, JWST promises many new exoplanet discoveries, and is already making the observations. Papers are already appearing on the JWST data, and it's conceivable that we may not have long to wait to see a candidate for a bio or technosignature. On the other hand, if it keeps coming up blank, we'll at least be able to start answering the question as to whether life in the universe is common or rare, or may take forms we currently can't recognize or detect. Interesting times ahead, indeed. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently sensing a bit of jealousy from the Hubble Space Telescope. Well, not really, but you know it's there. With JWST stealing all its thunder after decades as the top space telescope, I guess we'll know if unflattering Hubble images of JWST start coming down inexplicably to be leaked to the public. Very disturbing, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.